थोड़ी तुम प्याज काटो, तुमको सेंस नहीं है कि कितनी बड़ी प्याज काटनी चाहिए।
पार्टिसिपेंट्स आर रिक्वेस्टेड टू अनम्यूट देमसेल्फ। Guys, kindly mute yourself.
Ishika, you can start the session. We are all set.
Welcome, Ira ma'am. Am I audible to you?
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah. So, hello everyone. A lovely good evening to all present in the class of Hansraj. I'm Ishika Bhardwaj, Joint Secretary of NISHTHA, the Civil Services Society of Hansraj College. NISHTHA, a society founded in 2017, is a unique and innovative initiative by the students of Hansraj College. It aims at creating an ecosystem of passionate civil service aspirants to converge and provide an upper hand over other participants. Our passionate members, convener, council, and core members have made society a major asset for the UPSC aspirants. And it is considered by society analysts as the most esteemed society of the Delhi University. And now finally, we have another major and the most awaited flagship event, which is terminalized as the Class of Hansraj, a four-day event with four exceptionally good personalities of the nation. It brings me immense pleasure to welcome you all to the second day of our event. On this wondrous occasion, it gives me immense pleasure to welcome IAS Ira Singhal ma'am, a speaker who does not need an introduction. Currently, she is a joint secretary. Currently, she is joint director at Department of Social Welfare and Department of Women and Child Development Delhi. Previously, Ira ma'am has worked as director of community services, deputy commissioner, RP Cell and Parking, subdivisional magistrate, and has held various positions not only in the government sector, but also in the private sector as well. Ma'am has cleared the UPSC examination in 2014, achieving an All India Rank 1. She has been awarded with India's Today Woman of the Year 2015, President's Gold Medal for topping the IAS training, and the list goes on. She has received dual MBA in Marketing and Finance from FMS University of Delhi. She has been an awful inspiring speaker at more than 500 international and national conferences, industry forums, etc. Apart from all her achievements, it is worth mentioning that as an SDM in Alipur, she has rescued around 340 children and bonded laborers and restored them to their families. Thank you, ma'am, for your kind presence in the class of Hansraj. Over to you, ma'am.
My pleasure. So what we had decided that we're going to do this as a Q&A, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, thank you so much. Someone's writing in the comment section. Thank you, Janvi. Okay. Do you have any questions with you, or do you, how
yes,
do you want to start?
Okay, yeah, go ahead. So attendees can ask their questions in the chat box. My team would filter out the questions and they would be asked to the ma'am.
Perfect.
So ma'am, the first question is that we have learned that you have rescued around 340 children from child labor and securely returned those children to their family. So would you like to share that inspiring episode with us?
So it's not one rescue. It was actually 7-8 rescues that we did. And these are very technical things. So you must remember when we deal with children, it's very important that there is a guideline that we follow. So one, as an officer, it's very important that you are open to people coming and talking to you, you know, because a lot of the times what happens is officers are very closed off. So public doesn't come to you. And if people can't openly talk to you, you will never realize that the problems exist right under your nose. So one of the reasons I could do so many was because I was open to people coming and telling me when there was a problem. So I had all these people who knew about where this was happening and they would come and give me the information. And then we would plan all these raids and we would plan. So, you know, we you had to plan every single step. And remember, these are children and these are. So, you know, when as magistrates or as police, we go to a particular location and we rescue someone. Invariably, because the moment is so tense and it's so fast and it's, you know, synchronized on our end that people think that they have been arrested. So, you know, those little kids, we were rescuing them, but they actually think that they are being arrested. So it was very important that we made sure that those kids don't feel harassed. They don't feel like they've done something wrong. It was the world who was treating them wrong. So, you know, we had to plan every single step, right from who would talk to them, who would go inside which building, who would, you know, bring them out, what vehicles will they be in, when they reach my office, where will they sit, where is the medical happening, where is the, you know, statement happening of the children, who's doing what, and also we need to plan the timing of everybody. So, you know, you need to give proper slots to everybody, plus arrange for the food, arrange for the kids to be comfortable, arrange for the night stay for the children who couldn't be restored to their families, you know, and these are quite serious issues because when it comes to kids, it's every life saved, every future saved. So it was, you know, very gratifying work, if I may say so. You actually feel you made a contribution to the world around you because I believe it doesn't matter if it was 340, it could have been 3, and that still makes a difference. You still saved 3 lives. And it's not just me who did that, you know. It was the NGO partners who brought in the information, every single member of my team, the labor department, the child welfare committees, the police, every single person, you know, the medical team, all of those people, the child protection team, everybody had to be in the loop. And these are massive operations and it's very gratifying when you see the smiles on their faces of those kids once you brought them back. And some of the situations were terrible. You guys are very young. I wouldn't want to expose you to those situations, but these are really, really sad situations that unfortunately, you know, we're all privileged. We don't realize our privilege. We don't realize how much of an opportunity we've had. Just the fact that you got to go to school, just the fact that somebody cared at home to send you to school is very big. You know, you have to be very thankful for those moments. And if you can give any of these children a future, that's, I think, the best part of your day or maybe even your year.
Ma'am, yes, that's really, really inspiring. And like, we are very privileged compared to those kids, and those kids require so much.
Yes.
Yeah. So ma'am, my second question is that ever since you have been working in the Department of Women and Child Development, what are some of the challenges that you think are the great concern regarding women empowerment?
Okay, so the biggest problem is that women since birth have been convinced that they are less. The minute you are born, you're told that, oh my God, something went wrong and you became a girl. You know, women are born with the guilt of being a girl. And from that moment onwards, life and everybody around you constantly keeps telling you that you are less. There is something wrong with you being you. You need to, you know, be a certain way. You need to behave a certain way. You need to talk a certain way. You need to follow your life path in a certain way. And that's where things go wrong. because women are never allowed to think for themselves, to live for themselves. You know, you're always somewhere consciously made to mold yourself according to what makes other people more comfortable with your presence. You're constantly told you must know, learn how to adjust. Now, it's important for everybody to learn how to adjust. Unfortunately, it becomes the woman's responsibility that she needs to do that. And it's very sad. We get cases of women who are even financially independent, who are still not really in that place, who are still not ready to see themselves as independent people, as people who can take decisions for themselves. That's the biggest problem. Women are not ready to take decisions for themselves. The world does not support you taking a decision, and only about your life. You know, it's not even a decision about other people or things around, you know, that affect others. It's literally your own life, and you are not free to take those decisions as well. So that's the biggest problem with women empowerment. Convincing women, actually unconvincing them of all the things that the world has convinced them of. Making them think that they can take their own decisions, they can live for themselves, and it's okay to, you know, be themselves. So that's, I think, our biggest problem.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. My next question is, like, would you like to hear a bit about the working of the Department of Social Welfare, about their objectives, and about what this department tries to achieve?
Okay. So in social welfare, I deal with the, particularly my desk, I deal with the issues of disability as well as transgenders. And those are two areas that I've actually been working towards anyways in my last 5 years. Besides that, we also deal with senior citizens. We deal with people with leprosy cured people. All those other vulnerable sections, which are not caste-based vulnerable sections. So we have social defense for families, which needs support systems, beggars and people on the roads, vulnerable populations. And then we have senior citizens and, all those other sections. So we basically work towards, in a lot of cases, for example, for people with disabilities, it's more about empowerment. For people who are transgenders, it's about equal rights. For people who are senior citizens, it's more about making life comfortable for them. For beggars, it's about giving them alternate opportunities. So different categories of people with different needs.
Ma'am, it was a great from your side. I read it somewhere that you were the first officer to give a transgender person.
It was I think some kids need to mute themselves.
Yeah. Please kindly mute yourself. The session is going on. So, ma'am, moving on to the next question. So, of all the terrible things that are happening in the world, poverty, war, lack of universal education and healthcare, what do you think is the most important for society to work on?
Education. That's the only way we can move forward. That's the only way you can get people to a basic minimum. So, education, hands down, is the primary objective we must all have. Because without education, a person doesn't know how to make the right choices for themselves. And as government or as individuals, you can't go save everybody. You need people to be able to save themselves. I can't go make every woman empowered. She has to work for herself as well. I can just give her the tools. I can just give her a system. End of the day, it's about her own self. And unless you have education, knowing that you need to do it for yourself will not happen. So education is the biggest thing that you need.
I would request the
do you guys, can you mute as a host? Can the host mute
everyone?
Actually, what happens is when someone joins in new, they don't realize they're annoying.
Ma'am, am I audible to you right now? You are on mute.
Yeah, you're audible to me now. Good. Okay.
Yeah. So, so ma'am, like while you were SDM, so did you face any kind of threats from unwanted sources or someone trying to act as an obstacle in between your work?
Our work in such a way is designed in such a way that it always, people who are doing wrong things will always be affected. So that's a very regular, work hazard. And I think you join this service, so you can cure those things, So it's a regular thing. It's not something that you think about or you worry about, because obviously if you're rescuing children that people are paying less and then you're making them pay more, it hurts someone's interests, right? You're making people not, do a lot of wrong things. It obviously hurts some interests.
Ma'am, my another question is, how much your life has changed after becoming an IAS officer?
Actually, in my case, my life has not changed at all. I still live in the same house. I still, have the same friends. I do the same things. I just have a little less time. But other than that, not really, Mom. To be honest, your life will change if you think you need to change it. Your life changes the moment you decide that something needs to change or something needs to move, or you have a particular purpose to yourself. In my case, I wasn't looking to change my life. I was just looking to be able to make an impact. And I think that's the only thing. So now in my day, I make a big impact with a lot more many people than I did in my previous work and than I did in my earlier life. So that's about it. In my case, there's really no change beyond that.
Ma'am, coming to the responsibility, how your life has changed after becoming an IAS officer?
Responsibilities, you'll have to be a little more specific. That's a little vague for us.
Okay. So ma'am, my next question is, do you sometimes feel a kind of pressure or load, not only from the perspective of work, but also from the attention that the public gives you, because you're definitely called as a celebrity IAS officer?
I don't see things like that. And to me, I'm the same person. I live the same life. Attention will matter if you let it matter to you. To me, I see no reason for anybody to be put on a pedestal, higher than anybody else. All of us are products of our life situations and maybe sometimes good choices that we've made, right? To me, it doesn't really matter. I behave the same way. I talk to everybody the same way I would if I wasn't an officer. And I really don't see anything like that.
That's really inspiring act from your side. People,
your world changes the minute you decide you've become someone, right? If you start thinking you're someone better than others and you start putting yourself on a higher pedestal, then things change. You may lose people. You may not have the right people around you. I still have my friends who call me out and who tell me what I'm doing wrong. And it's exactly the same. I'm very lucky. I have people in my life who I've known for 20 years, 30 years. Yes, I am that old. It's precisely the same way.
Yeah. So ma'am, the next question is, ma'am, you have also worked with companies like Coca-Cola and Cadbury India. So how was your experience working in a private sector? Was there a sense of satisfaction in the job while you were working there?
So I was very lucky. I got extremely good companies and I got extremely good roles in those companies, especially Cadbury. That was amazing. The reason I switched my job is because of the internal satisfaction. Okay. But I did get amazing opportunities. I did get very innovative projects to do. And I was, treated very well. I was one of the fastest growing employees. And all of that. So it's not about personal, this thing. I did get a lot of personal sense of achievement. But for me, where I judge myself is, did I make someone's life better? Did my work affect someone in a positive way? Did my work, is there anybody who will say that because I was there or because I worked, their life has gotten better? And that was the only thing that was missing in my work. And that was the reason that I changed my careers, because I've needed my day to have meant something to someone. I needed to have made a difference to someone. Other than that, as far as work, general thing go, it was amazing. You get to travel all over the world. You get leaves, more than anything else. You get very easy leaves. The kind of responsibility we now hold, every little decision affects a few people's lives. If you make the wrong decision, you're also affecting people's lives negatively. Will make a huge impact. So every penny that we are spending is someone's hard-earned money coming to us. So it's important that we know how to be responsible for all of that and how you can spend it well and how you can use it well. And business school degrees sort of give you that. Business school my job is more about managing people, managing teams, managing my employees and getting everybody else to pitch into the same idea and doing that same work, which is where a business school degree sort of helps you into having your team on board. You understand how teams work. You understand what people's motivations are and you understand how things, how to get things done. So in that, I honestly feel MBA degree is pretty much one of the best degrees anybody should aim for when sitting for this exam.
Yeah, that's give an upper hand when the experience line.
Yes. Not just that, you understand how things work. It's not about an upper hand or a lower hand. It's not a power equation sort of thing. It's more about knowing how to get things done. And that is what we are sitting here for. We're not supposed to be technical experts. We're general administrators. And MBA is a degree of administration. So that's where it makes all the difference.
Yes. Ma'am, my next question is, like, you have read around 1,700 books. So which one is your favorite novel or book and why?
When you have read so many, it's so tough to pick one favorite. It's just a lot of them. I love a lot of books. I feel every book teaches you something. And I honestly believe that every person you meet also teaches you something. It's up to you to learn, but every interaction that you have, every person that you meet, and every book that you read will give you something to carry back. And I think I've learned from a lot of them, even if it's about emotional maturity, even if it's about what not to do in situations and how things can go wrong. So and judging people, if you read any of the mysteries, you understand people's motivations, you understand how people think and what sort of levels people can go to. So, in our kind of job, it's very important to understand people well.
Yes. Ma'am, my next question is, when did you choose to become a civil servant and when did you start its preparations?
So I decided to get into civil services. I wanted to get in since I was a kid, which was like 3-4 class, third, fourth or something. But really when I got into it was after working for 2 years after my business school. So when I worked and I realized that the emotional satisfaction that I was looking for was never going to come from the career that I had at that point. And like I said, I needed my day to have meant something. So that's when I decided to quit and give my civil services exam.
Yes. So ma'am, my next question is you secured lower in the prelims and you made exceptionally good in the mains exam in 2014 CS examination. What made you score higher? What was your inspiration?
Okay, you must remember this. Prelims doesn't matter. Prelims is only about clearing the cutoff. You don't need to score high in prelims. Why would you aim to score high in prelims? It's there's a very subtle difference between people who actually a lot of people who score high in prelims never clear mains. Because if you're scoring high in prelims, your preparation is more about mugging up facts, while mains is all about conceptual understanding. So if you've got your conceptual understanding, you will clear the prelims and you don't need to score high. Prelims marks don't ever get added. They're not relevant at all. It's only about being in that bracket. That's it. It's the mains which counts. It's the mains where your actual knowledge and your understanding of things is tested. So why do you care about... So my personal advice always is prepare for the mains and start with the preparation of mains. And then just before the prelims, just brush up enough facts so that you can sail through prelims. And remember, you don't need to get 100% in prelims. Like, why? It doesn't matter. You just need to clear that edge. That's it.
Yes, yes, that's really true. Ma'am, my next question is, what was the strategy and like, or we can say success month for UPSC prelims?
Like I said, prepare for the mains.
Okay, yeah, that. So ma'am, my next question is, what motto made you drive through UPSC hectic preparations?
Like I said, I needed my job, my day to have a meaning. I needed a job wherein I got to work with people to make lives better. And that was the only reason I got into this. And that was the only reason. For me, this was not about finding a career or finding a job. I already had those. And I had excellent ones in that, right? So it was simply about emotional satisfaction of being in the world and making a difference to the world around you.
Ma'am, my next question is, like, if there is one thing that everyone should do today to make their UPSC preparation smooth sailing, what would that be?
Stop listening to advice of everybody around you. Just don't. Most of the time, you're listening to the advice of people who have never cleared. So I absolutely get amazed when people come and ask me questions which all other aspirants are telling them, advice which other aspirants have given them. And I keep wondering, be logical, put yourself in the shoes of your examiner and then prepare. And, put yourself in the, instead of fear, let common sense rule you. So most of the time people work on the principle of fear. And a lot of the times people are so emotionally attached to themselves and not to the... One big mistake is people are only thinking of the exam. They're not thinking of the service. So you give the exam with the idea of clearing the exam and not about joining that service or being there to, have an aim which deals with that. Your aim is to clear the exam and everybody's preparation is just focused on that. I think that's quite... a bad strategy to have. You must move beyond the exam part and only then will you understand everything that's there.
A true point, and we should look forward to it before applying, started preparing for the exams.
Yes.
Ma'am, my next question is, what according to you is the biggest threat today in our society and how it could be overcome?
Ignorance. And overcoming it by education. And one of the problems is most of us listen to someone tell us something and we believe it. Another big problem is that you always believe the negative. You never believe the positive. Or you don't pay attention to the positive. One of the things is, if someone comes and tells you that person is horrible, you will believe it. If someone comes and tells you that person is amazing, you may not. I may not like you. But if you tell me that person, that third person is horrible, I will believe you. But I don't even like you. So it's amazing that we are ready to listen and believe the negatives so much that we forget to look at the positives in life. We forget to look at all the amazing things that life has to offer and things around us have to offer. And we don't analyze things for ourselves. We just believe someone else telling us. For example, the social media knowledge that is being imparted. Nobody bothers to check their facts. Nobody bothers to check whatever they've been told. It's usually just a simple Google search and authenticating things, but people don't take that time. We're so busy being quick in our judgments and quick in what we want to believe, and we never logically plan our arguments. So that's something we need to avoid. When you're thinking of something, be logical in your arguments. Try analyzing things better. That's, I think, one of the things we must teach our kids. And when I was director of education, I actually put it in as part of the curriculum, compulsory curriculum, that we need to teach our kids how to think logically. That's one big thing which has been missing. We've been teaching people to remember stuff and to know stuff, but we've never taught them how to analyze things and how to look at things from multiple perspectives. How to be empathetical and not sympathetical. Be empathetical towards ideas, towards principles, and towards people. So those are things I think we need to work on.
Yes, ma'am, you have rightly said that ignorance is the biggest threat in the society right now. So coming to the next question, ma'am, is there any sort of political interference in the job of an IAS officer?
Of course. But what does political interference mean? Okay, you cannot sign up for a job and then say your job conditions are interference. You literally sign up for a job which is headed by the politicians. You have signed up to be a bureaucrat, and all bureaucracy is meant to be headed by the politicians. So then saying that I don't like politicians coming and telling me stuff, why did you sign up for this job? Why did you come into this? See, it's up to you to be, don't think people can pressurize you into anything. You take those decisions yourself. If you stand tall and if you decide you are not going to be someone who can be bullied or be made to take wrong decisions, that's it. But that's also your choice. And you have literally signed up for a job which is about working with the political executive. Then saying it's political interference makes no sense. What do you think? It's a democracy that you've signed up for, not a meritocracy, not a bureaucracy-run country. It's a democracy. In democracy, it's elected representatives which run the country. Then you saying that I have cleared this exam, so now I don't want anybody to tell me what to do. I'm sorry. You signed up for this. You signed up for that job. And remember, no politician can make you do something wrong. What is the maximum they will do? Transfer you. Why do you care about that? You did not sign up to be in a particular position. You signed up to be a part of the service, and nobody can take that away from you. You signed up to be an IS officer, an IPS officer, foreign service officer, IRS officer, whatever, right? Nobody can take that away from you unless you do something wrong. And nobody can force you to do something wrong. You make that choice for yourself. You decide, I will listen to someone and I will take that call. You have a personal motive, which is why you take that call. You want to be in that position. You want to be in that seat, and that's why you let it happen. So, and you take that call consciously. You know, people can, so if my boss is asking me to do something I don't agree with, I will write that on file and I will send it ahead. It's up to my boss to take that call. I cannot be forced as an officer anywhere in the system to make a particular choice or a particular decision. Okay, so there is a system set for that. If you are someone who's making those choices, stop blaming others for it. You have made those choices. You have taken a conscious decision that you will get pressurized, because the only thing people do to you is they can transfer you. That's it. So why are you scared of that? Why does that matter? You did not sign up that I will be, for example, an SDM for the rest of my career. You did not sign up for that. You signed up to be a part of that service, and there are multiple posts on that. So you can't then have choices like that.
Yes, yes. My next question is, the aspirants want to know, when is the right time to start preparing for UPSC?
I personally think the right time is when you have an alternate career well in place. You must remember one thing. You are signing up for a job where you're going to take decisions which affect everybody else's life. Not about yours, it's everybody else's life. So do you think, why is it a bad idea to come in at your best? My job is not about intelligence, it's about wisdom. Wisdom doesn't come without having spent a few years doing things. My job is not about being intelligent. The exam is maybe about being, you know, smart, book smart, or, global smart or knowledge smart. But the job is actually about wisdom. It's about understanding situations. It's about making the right decisions which affect other people's lives. It's not about being, you know, the smartest person on the block. It's actually about being the wisest person on the block. So why should you not come into the service when you're at your, when you've gotten enough wisdom that you can now make right choices? And even from a personal front, this is an exam wherein 10 lakh people give it every year, 1,000 people clear. I'm going to be very, very blunt and actually give you the mathematics of how it boils down. And because this is not a math that most people look at. So out of 10 lakh people every year, 1,000 people get in, right? Out of those 1,000, 700 people are those that have gotten in a previous attempt. And roughly 3,000-4,000 people are those who are giving the exam the second time. So think about it. If we take a number of 4,000, out of 4,000, 700 will come in. That means 9,96,000 will only have 300 that get selected into any service. What happens to the rest of them? What happens to all those other people? And remember, every year that different chunk of people will come into that 10 lakh. So that 300 stays the same. Okay, so the number actually is 9,96,300. Those are terrible odds to play your life. You know, your life, you cannot be playing those odds. And if you cannot make a good career decision for yourself, will you be able to take good decisions for other people? When you're in that seat, you were made to make a good career decision for yourself. You didn't do that. You've not been a person who's taken good career, you know, good choices and good decisions for yourself. How can you be then trusted to make it for others? So, and why does your country not deserve you at your best? Why does the country not deserve you at your most productive, at a point where you're ready to make those choices and those decisions and those, plan those things for people? You're going to be planning people's lives. For example, I today plan how people with disabilities, how transgender people, what services they will get, what facilities we will put them. I plan for the future of kids that are rescued. I plan for children that, you know, I make children-based policies. I don't really talk about it, but I've been a part of CBSE career planning and a lot of other things, a lot of other national initiatives. I'm on board of the Election Commission of India. So there are all these things that you will get to do, all these decisions and policies you will be a part of. You cannot then be someone who's not at their best. And why should you not, why does your country deserve you at a lesser? And this thing, right? So I feel it's about feeling like you can make right choices. That's the moment. And I do think it's a smart thing to plan your alternate career. In my case, I actually, that's the reason that I did an MBA and also worked for 2 years. Because if you don't work after a particular professional degree, then the value of that degree goes away. So it's no point doing that degree then. So, you know, with a 2-year work ex, you can sort of, if civil services doesn't happen, you can come back and join the corporate sector at least the same level that you left it at. So 2 years generally becomes that benchmark. But for everybody else, I just want to say that do it at the point when you are emotionally ready to make those kind of tough choice decisions for others. I make a wrong decision today. A lot of transgender people, they may not get the opportunities that they deserve. I make a wrong choice today. A lot of women may be deprived of something. I deal with cases of sexual violence against children, women who've been facing these violent situations. Me making those wrong choices will affect all of those people. It will destroy lives. So that's my suggestion.
Ma'am, you have given a very nice approach, and I think it would have cleared the doubts of many aspirants. So coming to the next question, how do you think patriarchy affects our society?
Okay, one more thing. Ishika, it's 5:52. So if we're going to take people's questions, let's do that in the next 10 minutes because I have to leave in 15 minutes, yeah?
Yeah, sure.
So do you have more questions after this? Do you have many more questions?
Yes, ma'am, I have around.
Okay, we'll be quick. Yeah. We'll be quick then. Patriarchy, like I said, women from birth are not allowed to make choices for themselves. Women from birth are told that you are less, you know, and that's the problem. And in fact, in today's world also, we've been telling women, start feeling empowered, start feeling you can do everything, start, you know, feeling like you're equals. We have forgotten to talk to the boys. We've forgotten to tell the boys that, listen, girls are your equals. You also behave like that. So that's where patriarchy today stands, that all the conversations are happening with the women. All the conversations are about girls being told, you are equals, you are strong, you can do this, you can do that. But the other gender has not been told to let them be, to respect them as individuals, as human beings, and people that, you know, who need to treat others with the same respect that they think for themselves. So that's where we're still at. We're still at patriarchy, which, you know, hasn't, men haven't been told to treat women as equals. Women have been told you are equals. That disconnect still exists.
Yeah, ma'am, that's rightly said. Coming to the next question, like how you're able to manage time between your personal life and professional life?
I am somebody who's very, very good at time management and I don't waste any time. Most of us, we waste a lot of time. I actually do not waste time at all. Even if I'm watching a TV series or something, to me, that's time that I have slotted for relaxation. Okay, so even when I'm not doing that, me talking to my friends on the phone, going out, all of that is time that I have actively decided to spend on those things, you know, time that I've decided will be about meeting people, socializing and all of that. So give everything, a priority in life, and I then spend time accordingly, and I don't feel guilty about, not doing things and being in a particular way. So that's something that I do. And I think if you learn that early, it helps. So I don't waste time like that. I don't sit and daydream. If I have a, idea, if I want to do something, I actually then sit down and plan, how do I do this? And that actually is then time spent on planning. That isn't time wasted. Most of the times as students, you build castles in the air and then you forget to plan for how those castles will become a reality. And that's how you waste time. So whatever you're doing, you want to listen to music, have that as a time you spent on that, you know? And I always remember one thing that, like I said, you can always learn with from everyone. I was in 11th when my best friend said that, and she was just repeating what somebody else had told her, if you sleep, your fate sleeps with you. So if you're somebody who spends too much time sleeping, then your fate is also sleeping all that time. So, in Hindi, it's, tum so gaye to tumhari kismet bhi to saath mein so gayi. So, and that's something that I plan for everything else as well. Like, so I learn and, I picked up things all my life from everybody around me. And they don't have to be pravachan that someone is sitting and telling you. It's just little things in life that you will learn. You can learn from everybody, even little babies. So don't waste time. If you're doing something, know that you're doing it for a reason and be okay with it. Because when you decide that this is how I will do this and this much, I will spend time on this, I will spend time on daydreaming, it's fine. Then you can also get out of that faster. Yes. Yeah?
Yeah. Okay. Time management is the key to success.
Yes.
So coming to the next question, like ma'am, what kind of qualities does an IAS officer must possess?
I think the biggest thing is empathy. And listening, being able to listen to people. That's, I think, the biggest things. And remember, constantly remembering that you're here for a purpose and you're here to serve others and not for yourself. So, I honestly don't think you need to come into civil services if you want to be rich and famous. Please go do something else. There is so much more out there in the world, right? Honestly, corporate sector, when it comes to personal life, that's amazing. Corporate sector is fantastic, hands down, definitely much better. Here, the only thing you get in government is the satisfaction of making things better, making lives better, making contributing towards your country's growth in a much more hands-on way. So those are the only things you're here for. So if that's not what you're looking at and you're looking at some kind of personal glory and personal, achievement, why not go in the corporate sector? And especially, so today I make around 1/15th of what I would make in the corporate sector if I was today in the corporate sector. Okay. So what I make in a year, I would possibly make there in a month. Let's take it like that, right? So, the satisfaction is amazing. So I think that's where you need to kind of take things.
Yes. I'm coming to the next question. What is your opinion about the caste-based reservation system? Because it is always a debated topic among
I will not get into that debate here.
Yeah, sure. No worries, ma'am. Coming to the next question. So someone from the audience specifically wants to know about the strategies for the essay paper of UPSC.
I would suggest please check my blog. The links are given on my Instagram and my Facebook account. And if you just Google Ira Single blog, you'll get it. It's not that tough. And by the way, if your Googling skills are bad, you are so not meant for this preparation. So this preparation is all about learning how to use Google well. Please do it.
Coming to the next question. So ma'am, would you like to describe a bureaucratic system of India? How would you like to describe?
Where exactly, like what exactly are you looking at?
Like the bureaucratic, well, the whole process.
See, rules allow for neutrality. It's very easy for us if bureaucratic rules did not exist, a lot of people would not get those opportunities. For example, if the rule of UPSC and the neutral exam-based system did not exist, I would never be in this post. I do not have contacts and I don't have relatives. I'm the only person in my whole family who's in a government setup, who works in a government setup. I would never be here. I would never be allowed to even think of these positions or think of these jobs simply because A, I'm a girl and I'm a girl with disability. And I have no contacts. So we must remember that opportunities like this are open to a lot of us who weren't born with the luck that was needed to be in those positions. So that is the reason why bureaucratic systems sort of works in times. It also then delays things a lot, but then it also ensures that at least there's an opportunity which exists for all of us. Otherwise, a lot of us, and especially girls with disability would never get those opportunities. The world would never give you those opportunities if it was not forced to.
Ma'am, coming to the last question of the event. So life comes with a full circle to us. Like what according to you are the most important things that one should catch hold and keep in mind for constant growth?
So A, make your own choices. Don't be forced into choices by others. B, remember that, be honest with yourself. The biggest problem is most of us lie to ourselves about who we are. And that's where everything goes wrong. So to me, the key to, being able to do anything and being happy with yourself is about being honest with yourself. Accept yourself for whoever you are. If you're a lazy person, accept that you're lazy. Because till you accept it, you may not be able to change it. And accept and be okay with it or change it. Okay, so A, be honest with yourself. Don't let other people's opinions define who you are. Don't let other people's opinions tell you how to be, tell you who to be, tell you what to be. It's your life and the primary person you're responsible to is yourself and your conscience. So that happen that all the choices that you're making are choices that you've made basis what you wanted for yourself. And remember that you have a responsibility to the society as such to, be a good human being, but you don't really have a responsibility where other people's comfort and feelings beyond the regular are your responsibility. And that goes especially for girls that a lot of the times you're made to think of others as the primary people and put yourself down. Somewhere you need to learn to not do that. Answers your question?
Yes. So thank you, ma'am. It has been really motivating and great listening to you. So with this, we have come to the end of the event. I really hope that each and every attendee enjoyed the event and has learned so many things. Ma'am, it was such a motivating session by you and was truly a very cognizant session. So honorable dignitaries, my extremely dedicated team, respected Ira Single ma'am, and dear participants, I, Ishtika Bharadwaj, on behalf of Nishtha Society, the entire fraternity feel immense pleasure to take this opportunity to propose a vote of thanks to our eminent speaker, Ira ma'am, to spare the time from the busy schedule to grace this occasion with her presence. I also want to pay thanks to my team for helping me in hosting the event. My deep sense of appreciation and thanks to all the participants who choose to come live with us and attend the session with indescribable enthusiasm and made it a very successful event. Last but not the least, a very big thanks again to you, ma'am, for encouraging us and enlightening us. We really hope that you will always keep us this way. Our administration is fortunate enough to be backed by such intellectuals like you. So with this note, I want to inform the closure of this wonderful session with Ira, ma'am. Participants can follow us on the social media handles for updates, as Nishchay Society is very keen to hold such sessions very frequently. Do fill the feedback form circulated in the chat box. Thank you, ma'am, for joining us. Thank you.
My pleasure. And if any of you, especially the girls, have any questions as such, feel free to message me on Facebook or Instagram. You guys are free to do. I may not be answering how to prepare for UPSC so much because my blog links are given there. Please check that. That also covers interview and everything because I'm seeing the chat box and a lot of people have been asking questions on that. So guys, go check the, just like I said, just go check the blog. You'll get everything there. But besides that, if you guys have any specific sort of questions, please feel free to get in touch. And good luck to you all. Please make smart choices. Remember, this life is yours. What you put out in the world is what your image will be, what the world will remember you for. So do well for yourself and good luck. I hope you all have wonderful careers ahead.
Thank you, ma'am. Personally, you have so many doubts of myself and experience that really overwhelmed to listen to you. So thank you so
much. Thank you.
Guys, you can fill the feedback form in the comment section and the session is officially over, you can leave. Thank you, Ira ma'am, for joining. Thank you. Thank you, guys.